It's really wonderful to be invited to do this talk tonight and to have all of you here. We are here, of course, let's make sure this works that way, because as you demonstrated when you clapped uproariously with the idea that we're here to improve the lives of children, we're here because we're concerned citizens. We care about having a strong community. We care about the economic future of our country. And I assume that we all believe that the foundation of that is in healthy child development. Healthy child development forms the pillars for educational attainment, necessary, of course, to be able to have that, to have economic productivity, to have responsible citizens, to have lifelong health, as we're beginning to really understand that link between early development and lifelong health, and to have people who are able to go on and successfully raise the next generation. This is the foundation for the economic success and the moral success of our communities. And we're all here because we care about that. Healthy child development depends on healthy brain development. Whoops, there we go. The healthy development of brain architecture. And that's what we're going to talk a bit about tonight. What we have come to understand forms the basis for the healthy development of brain architecture for our children. Now, the healthy development of brain architecture, it's nice to have a good set of healthy genes. But healthy genes alone will not get you healthy brain development. Genes are critically important. Genes help determine when parts of the brain develop, where particular kinds of neurons go, how we set up the very basic structure of the human brain. But the brain develops, well, the brain becomes what the brain thinks about. It's an amazing process. The way nature has set us up, this is a cartoon of neurons. This is not exactly what neurons look like, but it's to give you a sense. And what you're seeing there, imagine the little light there are the electrical impulses traveling from one neuron to the next. To send a signal and have anything happen, neurons have to connect with other neurons. And you can see that there in these little, excuse me, I'm not sure you can see it at all. That doesn't, well, there it is. Connections between the neurons, that's a synapse, that's to indicate a synapse. And at a certain point in development, our brain suddenly has thousands and thousands and thousands of these connections, more than we actually need to think efficiently. What the brain does then is as it processes information, the places where information is flowing and being effective, those synapses get bigger, they connect. And the places that are not transmitting information, they begin to unhook and retract. And it's the coolest thing in the world, right? This is how we have evolved to develop brains that work in the context of our lives, that help us understand what to do if we live in Alaska on the steppes or the ice out there, and what to do if we live in the rainforest. We have a way of adapting our brains to our context. But what it does mean is that the brain becomes what the brain thinks about. This proliferation of connections and pruning doesn't happen at the same time throughout your brain. It begins in the back part of your brain with the basic perceptual systems. This is what babies are working on in the first months of their lives. They're getting those set up correctly by looking and hearing and so on. And then it proceeds to motor and emotional areas, and later on to the more complex memory, emotion, and learning. You think, of course, with your whole brain. It's very rare that you ever use one part of your brain for any problem. And with development, what you're getting is these wonderful connections occurring, getting strengthened, circuits developing, so that the brain processes information efficiently and well, so that you develop a sturdy brain architecture. And you have to wonder what nature was, and it's like building a foundation to a house. You need a firm foundation to develop a beautiful house above that. If the foundation is not firm, it's really hard to go back and fix that. The house on top will be wobbly, it will be influenced. With that information, you do have to wonder what nature was thinking. the most complex brain on the planet that requires the longest development, that needs information, is put inside of a creature that cannot get its hand to its mouth, lift its head off of the pillow, roll over, reach for anything, crawl to anything for months. By itself, the child cannot do what is needed to form healthy brain architecture. We really have to wonder what nature was thinking. Well, what nature was thinking is that we evolved to develop that healthy brain architecture in the context of relationships. And in the context of responsive relationships, well, babies run entire households. The child reaches out. As this baby is, the adult responds. The baby gets excited, the adult responds. We call this interaction or serve and return or call and response. But the whole process is one where the child's brain sends signals. They result in a behavior. A positive thing happens that confirms back to the brain, hey, that was a good thing. Feed those sort of synapses. That one worked. And in that process, you sculpt a very healthy set of brain architecture. Now, we know that all you have to have is one responsive, caring adult in the life of a child. But we also know that raising children is really challenging, and it's hard if you are the one responsive adult in that child's life to keep doing 24/7. What that child needs. Well, typically children are born into the context of many relationships that are all important. Grandparents, both parents, oftentimes, or at least two adults, teachers, other children, in a rich set of relationships where there's interesting things to do and the child is supportive, we have the context for developing a healthy brain. It is rocket science. But it's just basically what all kids need and what, as a society, we should be able to help make sure, ensure that all children have. Okay. However, we have many families who are under a lot of stress. We have many families where there are not a lot of adults who are there to be able to be supportive. We have many families who are really challenged by the income inequality that we are confronted. Everything is not perfect. So it should not come as a surprise to you that some of the barriers to educational attainment, and I was really asked to talk about whether age 4 is early enough. And my talk is, no, it's not. That doesn't mean we stop. We gotta go earlier, but we can't drop them at age 4 either. So why is it too late? This graph is an old study. It's been, however, repeated with fancy-dancy stuff and eye tracking and everything. So we know it really is telling a true story. This graph will show you on the far, is what it's counting is the number of words children know. Now, words are nice. We are getting to the habit now. We've been thinking about this of just throwing loads of words at kids. Yeah, may not be the right thing. Because words are labels for concepts. And I don't know if you remember a time like this. I remember being 5. Maybe I was already a psychologist. But I had learned a word. And I'm walking home, running my finger along the wall of on the retaining wall next to my house, because I really vividly remember this memory, thinking, wow, I learned that word. Now everybody's saying it. And then it struck me, maybe they'd been saying it all along, but because I didn't know the word, I didn't have the concept, I wasn't hearing it. And that's the thing about language. It opens up a world of concepts to you. So we say skill begets skill, right? Learning language opens doors to learning more stuff. So it's not just knowing the words, it's the fact that these words are opening the doors. And what this study showed us, and it was done by social class, was, and that is only a correlate, right? Not everybody who is poor is not speaking a lot with their kids. But if we count the number of words that children are speaking up to 16 months, there's not much of a difference, thank you. But by 36 months, that's our achievement gap. So by age three, we are seeing the achievement gap in language. And that also means in concepts, and that means what kids come to school ready to learn more. We now know that it also parallels what we see if we look at brain development. So if you love Hercule Poirot, you know he talks about those little gray cells. That's what they were looking at here, was the volume of the gray matter in the brain. They were following the same kids. And at 5 months, there's no difference by social class. By 3 years, there is. That matches what I told you. The brain becomes what the brain thinks about it. The brain can think about more stuff. It forms more connections, etc. It is not over at age three. That is not what those kids' brains will necessarily be an adult. But it means they walk into school with fewer connections, fewer words, and they're playing catch up as early as age two, actually. So now the question becomes, not only what the brain needs, but what the brain doesn't need. And I'm going to switch here to stress. This is a picture of your adrenal glands. These are these little hats that sit on top of your kidneys. They produce adrenaline and cortisol, two major stress hormones. The brain needs, this helps us stay alive, by the way, guys. You don't want to take your adrenal glands out. Really a bad plan. Okay. And before I go into the stress part, I want to make sure you understand that we do not want to wrap our children in bubble wrap. That actually, like many things in physiology, that which I call the Goldilocks principle, typically too little, too much, not good. Some degree of stress is actually facilitates brain development, so it's good to let your kids get frustrated, try hard, et cetera, et cetera. Maybe have a few days of distress when you leave them at childcare. This is all good. Okay, the issue we worry about is when you get stress hormones produced at high levels for long periods of time. That's what we call toxic stress, and it can be damaging to the brain. What you're seeing on the left is a brain cell, all those nice little connections. On the right is the researchers dumped stress hormone on that brain cell, and it retracted a lot of its connection possibilities. Yeah. Actually, that's a cell from the reasoning part of the brain, the hippocampus or the prefrontal cortex. In the emotion centers of the brain, where you learn fear, the reverse happens. The more stress hormone, the larger the connections. So basically what the brain is doing, nature doesn't hate us, but if the world is dangerous, our brain is adapting to become a think now or act now, think later brain to keep us alive. It makes it hard to go to school, though. So that's what it's doing, is helping to shift the energy away from the learning parts of your brain. And as we know from trauma-informed education, needing to create an extra safe environment for these kids so they don't kick out of the learning mode and into the fear mode. Okay. So how do we act on this? Our evidence is pretty clear that the plasticity of the brain decreases as these circuits form, etc. And, what it takes to change the brain increases. Not that we can't do it. There is no kid we ever give up on, but it's going to take more time and effort. So as a society, it makes sense that we do some careful planning to make sure that during this time when the brain can get up, set up beautifully, that we're making sure that as a society we are supporting the kids and their families so that that will happen. How do we do that? Well, there is no silver bullet. And this is the thing that worries one as a scientist, that when we think about policy discussions and we totally understand why we think this way, everyone is looking for should we do this or that? If we only have so much money, should we do this or that? I want to argue that as a society, we need a good 10-year plan or a 15-year plan that's comprehensive, where we work together and figure out what we need to do as a society to feed our children the right way. That's absolutely essential for healthy brain development. And to worry about young families, make sure they're supported. It is hard work parenting. If you were not parented well, it is especially difficult. I don't know about you, but when I had little kids, and I know what you're supposed to do, I could watch myself on bad nights going, whoops, you goofed there. Whoops, that was bad. Woo, you got three wrong. Good thing kids are sort of forgiving. If I were living a more highly stressful life, if I didn't know where the next, whether I could pay for the rent, if I didn't know where the next meal was coming from, I don't think my kids would have lived through that, let alone done well. So we need to support families so they can support their kids. We need, families have to go to work. And in our most high-risk families, they may hold two or three jobs. They need safe childcare and good childcare for their children. Where kids have a chance to learn exciting stuff. I get upset when I hear about kids this age being talked about as students. I know we need the education system to take care of them, but these are kids whose primary need, they need to learn, but their primary need is to feel safe and secure with people that they are attached to, emotionally secure with. That is the primary job of a teacher of very young children. The rest follows with a good curriculum and so on. But we got to start with a different attitude towards our youngest guys, right? And that means that we need to really support the people who are working with them. They have a tremendously big job. Not only do they have to be the secure base for these kids, they also have to, have you ever thought of having a party for a two-year-old and have the kids come and stay all day and there are 12 of them or some god-awful number? It is really hard. And it takes... And I don't know if you've noticed, but little kids, you don't say, we're going to learn numbers now, and they all sit down and say, okay. So you have to be an amazing analytic processor, because you take the kids where they are, you notice an opportunity, and you support the learning that the child's doing. I've often thought if I wasn't doing what I was doing, the most difficult other job that would be exciting and analytic would be to be a preschool, nursery school teacher, because it's a, you got to be really smart, and you got to think on your feet. And we don't pay many of these people more than we pay the people who are at doggy daycare. Nor do we provide the training for them. In fact, and this is a wonderful report that just came out last year, Worthy Work, Still Unlivable Pay. During the period of most rapid brain development, we pay the people who work with our kids the absolute least. Many of these people cannot get by without being on food stamps. This is a sin. And if we decide that we're going to do preschool for four-year-olds, we need the right curriculum, and we need teachers trained to teach four-year-olds. Kindergarten should not be the new second grade. Preschool should not be. So we got to get rid of the worksheets and so on. And again, we need exciting curricula that engage children and teachers who know how to create that curricula and use it to teach the ABCs, to teach words and learning and all the things that you absolutely can do in that context in playful learning. And it's not done when they're six. We cannot expect to do great things for young children and then dump them into a school system that doesn't do for them, that we don't provide enough funds to do for them what they need. The last time I checked, well, it's not done till they move out, which could be ages. But if we work together, we can think of a comprehensive set of plans across the community to work over the years to create ultimately the kind of context we want for our communities, for the families and children there, so that we will all have a bright future. Thank you.